That was kind of the first phrase I thought about when I had the invitation that we've had this nice visualization of what we need to do to avoid the spread of the COVID. And then a few weeks after, I saw this one circulating on the social media about the Earth capacity. So it's obvious that a lot of people are seeing these two crises as deeply connected, which I think is interesting to the whole situation. And I think it's interesting both in, you can say, in an industry perspective, but also at a personal level, when we look at how we interact with our wardrobes and clothing. And as some of you know, I have also, just like England, been very occupied with wardrobe studies for quite a long time. So I will try to say a little bit about both, what this could mean, this crisis we experience now. So in an industry perspective, there was a letter from some Danish fashion trade organization to the DK government asking out for help, for financial support. And I came across this sentence that said, if our products are not sold immediately, they are worth nothing. This is how it is in a sector that drives on seasonal change. And some of the reality behind this is that, for example, we have a very a big fashion company called Bestseller. They received 6 million clothing items per week from Asia that they needed to rent a lot of containers outside of their headquarters to store all of this clothing because the shops were closed. So they now have a whole like a container city just filled with newly produced garments. And I think this sentence is just completely grotesque. It's a lot of clothing items that took a lot of resources, work, flying across the globe, whatnot. And then just because of fashion trends, it's supposedly not worth anything. And to me, this is the whole thing we need to discuss and change ultimately. So there's actually a lot of things happening in Denmark, and this began already before the COVID. So in January 2020, the Copenhagen Fashion Week launched an action plan. This action plan has been developed together with international researchers, which is highly unusual for the fashion sector. The ambition is, or the goal is now, that before 2022, you cannot have a fashion show at the Copenhagen Fashion Week without committing to a point system of sustainability on both production and consumption side. So that's quite ambitious, and I have no idea how the Danish fashion companies are going to reach this goal, because at the moment they are really, really, a lot of them are very early adopters, and to them sustainability work is mostly about changing one fabric with another, a supposedly sustainable fabric, but they're not changing the whole narrative and logics. But here in the, yes, and also right before the COVID, I was an external expert for a governmental council, a climate council, to inform government of how can we reduce CO2 with 70% emissions in the area of trade and textiles. And also these recommendations are quite ambitious. And of course, we don't know how it's going to look like in regulations, but it just shows that this is actually together with industry, this is industry players themselves asking for a quite radical change. So something is definitely happening. And then after the COVID came in, we have initial studies showing how even very, like previously very conservative retailers and companies, they are now building really strong sustainable strategies, and they're completely abandoning previous logics about how they sell and promote garments and clothing. And I think that's extremely interesting. Also, we are a country where 9% of all our new clothing purchases are secondhand, and 38% of Danes buy secondhand because they are worried about the climate. And this fall, the fashion fair is going to completely revise the format because they think it doesn't make any sense to have a fair that is only about selling new seasons and new trends. So they will start introducing advice on how to do sustainability transition work as a service instead. So there's a lot of things happening, and it seems it's being rapidly escalated due to the virus. So I can see from my seat two strategies in industry. The one is, of course, the ostrich who puts the head in the sand and says, I'm just going to wait here until normal gets back, and that will be very nice. But there are actually surprisingly many who is starting to look into more like systemic ecologically founded ideas about how to completely transform. So I see a reducing of seasonal collection. I see reduction of collection volumes. I see an interest in circularity. So I see a lot of things that are being escalated these months. So that was kind of the industry, what I see going on there. Yes, thank you very much. So to the more personal side, I've been thinking a lot about a line in a poem called I Civilize Myself in the Morning. And we have been, more of you have been telling about this. This is me yesterday after 12 hours of research application work in my garden. And you can see that maybe that after some weeks, I skipped the bra. And I mean, why? Nobody can see it on Zoom. I wore just the black comfy clothing, my garden clogs, no makeup, also for meetings. So, I mean, these borders between private and public, yes, they are breaking down. I also reflected on the fact that we have changed seasons, a lot of us. So many of us pack down the winter clothing and take out the summer clothing. And so every year we revise our wardrobe. And for me, this has meant that I have been taking these items to a tailor to have them adjusted because I realized they were ever so dear to me, but the fit was bad. And I think this is somewhat is starting to happen, that people have been just sitting there facing their own collection. So there have been some kind of wardrobe self-care, as more of you have also talked about earlier. So I made a little mini survey on Facebook, and I asked people to send me pictures of their COVID uniform, work uniform, home wear, and just to say a few sentences about it. And I really like this woman to the right who wore her comfy, healthy sandals, but with the glitter stockings. So this way she could be a little bit civilized. And you see other attempts of trying to maintain some kind of civilization whilst also, you know, being at home and definitely not restricting your body. So I came to think a lot about the whole body of knowledge on reform dressing and the soft dressers movement 100 years ago. About liberating the body, because lots of us have been liberating our bodies a lot. So maybe we will not go back the same way. We don't know yet.
Thank you.
And they also sent me pictures of what will I wear when I get out. And of course, there's something about that when we went here in Denmark, we went in inside our homes the 12th of March. It was really a dark and stormy, rainy day. And here, when we are allowed to start to get out, it is spring. So of course, these colors are spring-ish. But still, it's the joy of being able to dress up again that are definitely here. And you can see on all the lovely colors and high heels and restricted body wear like bras and stuff that people are really looking forward. And so my final picture is my own, my little hashtag, no slippers. So the first time I went out to a bar after being isolated in several months, it's just there's something very special about, Ingun talked about occasion. We haven't had this occasion of going out for 2.5 months or something like this.
So, ну что, Алиса, как ты там?
Sorry. Can you?
I don't know. It's somebody who forgot to switch off the sound. It's important for those yep. who are not presenting. Switch off the sound, please. Mm-hmm. Yeah, all good. Sorry about that.
Yeah, it's completely good. So I think that overall there's a divide between just we are eager to get back to the previous normal, but there's also a really considerations on both, you can say, consumer or user side and industry side on how can we make use of this, you can say, little break in the world go around to kind of rethink a way that is more robust and healthy and resilient for the future. So on my side, I'm actually quite optimistic, even though it's a bizarre reality we experience. So thank you very much for listening, and please pose questions. And Ludmila, thank you so much. Like a whole day with the clothing nerds, what can be better?
Thank you so much, Else. Yes, I agree totally. Yeah, I did it all for myself. Yeah. Okay, thank you so much. I wonder if the sparkly socks in a couple of slides which you showed were the same of the lady, yes, who
yes.
wore. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
So it's the same sparkly socks, but she will wear the high heels when she gets out, and she right. purchased them during the COVID.
Yeah, right.
So, yeah.
Okay, right. Comments, questions? Agata has a question. Yes, sure. Switch on the sound.
Yeah. Okay, hi. Thank you very much for the presentation. It was just like a food for the eyes and for the ears. I have a question regarding the industry that you mentioned. Do you have like any insight or maybe any gossips about whether the choices of the garments that are being purchased? I mean, you mentioned that it does not show an increase in purchases during and after the COVID in Denmark. But yeah. I mean, do you have any kind of hint? Maybe just at least in a qualitative level, is it something different than they buy? I mean, did they came back to just replacing what they had, or is it something new that they are adding yeah. to the wardrobes? Thank you.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I don't know anything particularly about the types of items, but that was what I was referring to in the second last slide about, you know, will we... It was just like when we started wearing trainers in my generation when I was young, and we kind of just refused to stop wearing them. So they need to produce soft trainers for us for the rest of our lives. And I think there might be something happening here that we will, I don't know, because I mean, when we are out again, we will also enjoy like being uncomfy again and being dressed up and being restricted and all these lovely things that we do to play around with clothing. So maybe it will just be a lot of really sparkly, colorful things, but I don't have any qualitative indications, no.
Okay, thank you very much.
Elsa, we have a question. Has anyone worn, from Sophie Wood, has anyone worn their going out clothes at home?
Yes, I hear, I have heard more because I put up some, some Facebook questions to people. What are you wearing now and how are you coping with all of this isolation? And also so it's really qualitative, it's not a study, but there has been like Zoom parties where people insisted on dressing with the full Monty, you know, high heels, makeup, everything, even though you can only hear the shoes clapping in your living room. So there's been kind of an insisting on being civilized and dressed up, even though you were just on your own. And I think also this thing that we only see each other's heads. So it's, I had this crazy fantasy that if this went on, we would move all fashion to the head. And even there has been a lot of design for avoiding face recognition. So there are quite a lot of new design and actually accessory for the face to distort face features. So in my own little fantasy, I just imagined that we, if we kept on, we would need that because we need to talk with each other. And also there's this discussion about Zoom fatigue, that because normally when we talk, we do use a lot of body language to understand each other. And I think clothing is a huge part of that. And as we cannot see the whole body, people are simply having burnouts because they're trying to read what's going on in the room, what do these colleagues really mean, and all of this.
Mm-hmm. yes, yeah, so actually, and everyone, yes, everyone would like to use clothing nerd. They liked, yes, the expression. Okay, yeah. And yes, one comment from Claire Rose. I was asked to participate in a video for a friend's wedding, dancing to a 1960s song. So of course, I wore my 1960s dress and then a party outfit for a selfie for the wedding ceremony. So
yes, because it is. I mean, it is a little weird to be at these Zoom parties and then you're fully dressed and then you're just wearing like a homemade socks. So it conflicts the whole body experience, definitely.
Yeah, all right. Thank you, Elsa. Thank you so much for your presentation.